given the fact that of how this takes place is in a moment in time where they're experimenting on black people, trying to determine the validity of like whether how smart they are or things of that nature. Actually, the gears depicted in this picture are actual gears. Like, I based them off of actual gears.
Wow.
Another thing is, because she's jotting down her confessions, it's a pencil, but it's also like a Xacto blade.
Mm. Ooh.
And I thought about, how we treat ourselves as supposed to, conduct ourselves in a certain way as royalty. That's why I went ahead with purple. The green is basically like how they're supposed to gain all this truth. The whole concept.
It was said that every man should have his own home. Every child should have his own mother to rest his head against her chin. And I believed you. The domino coloring that played the tune of foreign tongues from the fourth grade when you loved to intoxicate us with Carver and his peanut and all the digestible parts of Harriet Tubman. You made her sound like a scared Negro when in fact she was more man than your favorite president. I believed you when you said all men are created equal until you showed me my own color, until you made it known that it didn't belong to me. And this is a government for white men, according to your presidents. You made it known that my home wasn't on this land. Home resides a great distance from these American shores, and therefore you had a perfect place for my kind, a lifestyle that dirtied what the creator made beautifully. I believed you when you arrested my brother, made my father pollute himself with some of the best street side get high you could find. I believed you even after you cussed my mother, even after you prepared early graves for my babies whose faces I will never see. I remember how danger found us in high school's hallways and how we learned that policemen were just overseers with badges and guns. You made us believe you. So we permed our hair, drew colors along our eyelids as if our beauty couldn't hold on to its own weight. I believed you when the cancer came in, when you made these man-made diseases that rocked our neighborhoods and crack came in and fathers lost themselves, mothers gave up all of their preciousness. You made us believe you and all that you said of us, everything you dumped against our mighty ancestors. I believed in names like nigger and darky, three-fifths, and Christians under a foothill of teachings you would have to oversee. I believed you. I believed you when you made the world swallow itself. And the pale face made our ancestors junglemen, made us target practice and game, even set your bloodhounds to vampire our existence. You drank of all that we didn't own, our bodies, our future, the naked images we saw in the mirror that carried your favorite flavor. You knife and forked your way through so many atrocities, switch up the narrative to prove your dislike for breathing black bodies. Even every halo you saw belonged to a bullseye. Our light always blinded you to execution and manslaughter. It always has been your duty to swear to uphold our birthrights. Shoot us down as if there was a reward on the end. I can only hunt wildlife when it permits, but to you, black bodies have no off-limit signs. And to you, we are always part of hunting season.
Damn, Jaw.
Damn, you need to give us like a minute, a full minute after that, because my dear God, like, oh my God, that was
fucking. It's called In Temporary Madness. Hey, right there underneath that chair, you'll soon get to see the ones that laugh at the dead, leaving the others on red, while the two corded ice from within, it can never bleed out, even if it's shot out. To the other ones running rat races and raiding races, holding their breaths, forgetting the pace and outrunning the whip, for they don't seem fit. Yet, please don't forget the sick, for they always feel as they are to be left to get the short end of the stick and never get enough of a pop-up shop while all cracks are to pop. To notice how you hyperventilate off the future while your toes let frozen in the past. No, these days are not meant to be lived hidden away. No notification is meant to be left unread. Because the thing about hiding from the world is that you start hiding from yourself, unable to lose up the grip between molars, saying to yourself that not relying on others is the way to be. Isolated, we are all split, seen as fit. And a grow of cynicality painted amongst your walls with no acceptance of it all. No, these days are some strange ones. But the times reminds us nothing is to remain the same, as the only thing perpetual is change. So I say to thy human that while in temporary madness, all will sound distorted. So might as well go outside and listen to some wind chimes in the meantime.
I don't know. I wrote this after George Floyd died. And I just feel like it's not even worthy of what it represents, but I don't know. I'll just read it. I think it's okay. It's titled the number four. I have done nothing yet in this life to warrant a halo or wings or an entrance into heaven. My life has yet to accomplish anything great, yet to relieve hunger, violence, or the cancer of systemic racism. I am no one special or memorable. You'd pass me on the street, not stop to shake my hand or embrace my arms. That's why it was so confusing at first how I managed to get way up here, heavy halo crown, because I drown in my own breath that you took from me so the whole world could see my death. I cried out for my mother, cried out for my children, cried out in pain, cried out to live, fated to die instead. Dead is my body, but alive is my purpose. I am a sculptor now. The earth between my hands, I squeeze and smear. It is changing now. You are changing now. We are changing now. 100,000 body bags on TV, and mine is the one you can't unsee. Black, white, it is not a gray matter. Black as the bag, my cold skin has returned home, for no home is safe, no person immune, no life protected, unless we all stand up, unless we all speak up, drive out the hate, make every moment count until we stop counting these body bags, stop wiping wasted tears. Calm the fury hastened on the streets. There will be no rest. There should be no rest. My steps fall beside my children, beside you who march, you who believe I will be the last lamb to slaughter. For I am a sculptor now. I am sculpting you a new world. Be my voice of change. Be my heart of love. Be my breath of life, and indeed live on.
Let's go. Yes, Marissa.
Ah, damn. Fantastic.
Bring me all the smoke. Is,
pulling off scabs for scars. I pull off scabs so nothing is left behind in its aftermath, but there's always a remnant. I don't plan on remaining, but it does. A scar starts as a reminder. The remainder of accumulative happenings that caused it to happen in the first place. I profess scars as beautiful in the mirror, tracing a nose broken through an angry fist to my face, and self-made scars I've been making since I was 5. That's when it all started with me. when my innocence was lost, but I never was a child. That's why I felt like an old soul trapped in a young body, and no one listened to me when I exclaimed that other kids seemed to fear me for what I just couldn't admit to myself. I was the other, marked by the transgressions I didn't bring about with his body weight against me. And I thought if I stopped breathing, maybe they couldn't see me, but they were always bigger, heavier, more substantial than me. So I had to give in, cave into them. Like a collapsing wall that was sheetrock against foundation. My foundation was never made to be steady, so the scars kept multiplying. I made them beautiful in my mind because they kept saying, at least I lived life. And I kept replying, not the way I wanted to live it, on another's expertise of a body not made to be pillaged, but was plundered, and how I ever come back to my body, breathe, feel my heart still beating, even if at times I'm numb to my pain. Sometimes I'm the bullet to my brain, and it exits my skull, leaves just a scar covered by scalp. Those are my remains. Yeah, so.
Woo! I love you, and I love your poetry.
And I have this poem about this woman that I knew when I was a kid, and I didn't see her for years until, like, one day I was driving in Charlotte, and she was on the side of the road, and she was clearly on, like, really, really, really severe drugs. So this is about that. And I think it kind of adds that visceral beauty that is like part of the language that's in this book. So I wanted to share it. So here it is. Yesterday, I saw her and her best friend fighting on the side of the road. And her face was covered with open sores. It looked like life drug her down a highway she wasn't equipped for. The two women both had their fists balled up, but both refused to hit each other. Two gray-skinned silver slivers of women, just as thin and wavering as heat rising off pavement. Terry was saying, "I know, but it ain't so bad." And Julia was saying, "I can't do this anymore. We got to get off the meth. That son of a bitch choked me too hard last night in bed." There wasn't anything in the car I could offer up to save her if her best friend can't. Was it any bar of soap to help her feel clean enough? No bottle of water to quench the dire thirst for drugs? Was it any shelter safe enough? Today, she is half Scarlett O'Hara in dollar store makeup to cover up the aftermath, half lioness, half ghost, floating above the sidewalk. The high has just kicked in, sunshine blasting through her veins, and she turns and looks my way as if she knows, her eyes telling me, when I was a little girl, I wanted to be a princess. Watch me twirl in my euphoric gown. Am I pretty now? Am I pretty now? Am I pretty now? You know, no one wants to grow up to be a crackhead. It just happens. But Terry, your fairy tale hasn't ended. You can still write in a happily ever after. I know people tell you you took the easy way out, but you never saw there was another choice, never knew you had the power to change course, and they didn't see how hard it really was. Today, she is sun goddess, each step a blaze of ecstasy, scorching the street with her bare feet. She feels like a queen, but it's only an induced movie she chases to play on repeat. I am worried about her tomorrow. I am worried about tonight when the pipe and the needle come calling for more of her. When the little princess inside has to hide in the closet so she don't face what she's become. Terry, be the goddess you are and burn. Terry, you still deserve happiness. Terry, you still deserve to be a princess.
My gosh, Shane.
Oh my God.